Let's set the clocks back. The year is 2002. In terms of pop culture, the infamous Nickelback has the top-rated song with How You Remind Me. The Rings and Harry Potter are only on their second film of their franchise. The Star Wars prequels has their second film too with Attack of the Clones, and X-Men 2 hasn't even come out yet. What am I even doing? 2002? Looks like I'm learning how to read or something. But in 2002, superhero movies would change forever. Yeah, the first X-Men did well, but the last two Superman and Batman movies were just plain terrible. The concepts of the DCEU or the MCU were just fantasies. The closest thing we ever got to a shared universe was that little reference in, Batman and Robin. You know what I'm talking about.
I want a car. Chicks dig the car.
This is why Superman works alone.
Yeah, there are some straight-to-home Marvel shows, like, or movies, like the Fantastic Four thing that they had going on, the Lou Ferrigno Hulk, but that was really the extent of it. So, sometime in late April or early May, I go to see Spider-Man. And you know what? I love it. It has everything a six-year-old me would want. Action, bright colors, and it doesn't look cheesy, at least for the time. And to say that I love Spider-Man would be an absolute understatement. Spider-Man was one of the few pop culture things that I never miss a beat of. And yeah, I love Raimi's trilogy, and I also love the MCU portrayal of Spider-Man. There is something that just feels left out, though. That's right. Marc Webb's Amazing Spider-Man franchise. I've noticed that it is the most disrespected live-action adaptation of the character. I hear things like, you can't beat the original, Tom Holland is the best of both worlds, or Andrew Garfield is just too cool to be Peter Parker. Well, you know what? I think it's all BS, so let's break it down. In order to have a movie work, it's pretty simple. You have to have a good plot, unless it's something weird like Napoleon Dynamite. A common complaint I hear about in the first film is that it's marketed as the untold story. And you know what, I get it, that's a valid criticism, and I completely agree with that. But when you get down to the actual film, Peter Parker has a much more fleshed out character arc than both its predecessor and successor. Yes, Raimi's film is more straight to the point, and after the death of Uncle Ben, he takes up the mantle of Spider-Man, and you know what, it works. But you have so many iterations of Spider-Man, and as long as you don't blatantly disrespect the source material, it's okay to make changes. Another common complaint that I see is that Uncle Ben doesn't say, with great power comes great responsibility. Yes, the scene in the first film is awesome, but the criticism just honestly falls flat. Because you know what? Uncle Ben never said that in the original Spider-Man canon, contrary to popular belief. In the original Spider-Man canon, it was just a quote said at the end of Amazing Fantasy 15. I believe it was a quote of Teddy Roosevelt or something. I don't quite remember the exact logistics of it. But later on, in Ultimate Spider-Man number 4, he does mention great responsibility. And you know what? Let's pull up the actual quote, but let's first pull up the scene, and then I'll show you the quote.
Listen to me, son.
Yeah, go ahead.
You're a lot like your father. You really are, Peter, and that's a good thing. But your father lived by a philosophy, a principle, really. He believed that if you could do good things for other people, you had a moral obligation to do those things. That's what's at stake here. Not choice, responsibility.
He believed that if there were things in the world that you could offer, things that you did better than anyone else, things that you could do to help people, or make people feel better about themselves. Well, he believed it wasn't just a good idea to do those things. He believed it was your responsibility to do those things. The next complaint that follows is that Peter Parker starts off on a path of vengeance. What's the big deal with that? So, you're saying a 17-year-old kid should just jump straight into a career of crime fighting with no character arc in between. It's not that Peter is acting like Thanos trying to wipe out half the population, just being a complete maniac like the Joker, or anything in between. He's just trying to avenge his uncle's death. But things change up in this key scene right here.
Jet Spider guy yet?
No, we didn't catch him yet, but we will. He's an amateur who's assaulting civilians in the dead of night. He's clumsy, he leaves clues, but he's still dangerous.
He's assaulting people? I'm not sure. I mean, I saw that video of him and the car thief, and I think most people would say that he was providing a public service.
most people would be wrong. If I wanted the car thief off the street, he'd already be off the street.
So why wasn't he then?
Let me illuminate you. See, the car thief was leading us to the people who run the entire operation. It's been a 6-month-long sting. It's called strategy. I'm sure you're aware of the term strategy. You've probably heard about that in school.
Yeah.
Good.
Well, obviously, he didn't know you had a plan.
You seem to know an awful lot about this case. You know something that we don't know? I mean, whose side are you on here?
I'm not on anyone's side. I saw a video on the internet.
Oh. You saw the video on the internet. Well, then the case is closed.
Well, no, I'm just saying if you watch the video, maybe he sends you a link. It looks like he's really trying to help.
Yeah, sure, on the internet he's being made out to look like some kind of masked hero or something.
No, I'm not saying he's a hero. I don't think he's a hero at all.
What are you trying to say?
I'm saying he's trying to help, but it looks like he's trying to do something maybe the police can't.
Something the police can't?
I don't know.
What do you think we do all day? Think we just sit around eating donuts with our thumbs planted firmly up our asses?
Daddy.
Think we do down there?
Up your what, Dad?
Howard.
I think he stands for what you stand for, sir. Protecting innocent people from bad guys.
I stand for law and order, son. That's what I stand for, okay? I wear a badge. This guy wears a mask like a, you know, like an outlaw. He's hunting down a bunch of criminals that all look the same, like he's got some sort of personal vendetta. But he's not protecting innocent people, Mr. Parker.
Let's get some air, Peter.
This isn't the most fantastic dialogue ever written, but unlike the previous Spider-Man film, you actually get to see another person's perspective. Why does J. Jonah Jameson even hate Spider-Man? You never actually find that out in the Raimi trilogy. And then, when it comes to the Green Goblin in the original Raimi trilogy, yeah, Willem Dafoe's performance is great and all, but other than the fact that he was let go from Oscorp, what are his other character motivations? Really sit and think that one in. But then, right after this scene, this happens.
Help! Just a normal guy. Right? Want to hold to this? Hold to my mask. All right. What's your name?
Jack?
Yes.
Let's get you out of here. Okay. Stay very still.
All right.
Okay, I got you.
This is it. This is the key moment when he becomes Spider-Man. He's been doing all of this vigilante stuff, and then finally he actually sees what it is. After his conversation with Captain Stacy and everything, and you know what, it's fine to have a straightforward, with great power comes great responsibility, but there's not really a character arc with that. There's a little bit of a montage here and there, and the next thing you know, he's fighting the Green Goblin. Speaking of the Green Goblin, I always hear about how great such and such is with the Green Goblin, but at the end of the day, I mean, he actually is the Green Goblin, but what is his relationship to Spider-Man? Check this out right here.
Don't let him take me again. I beg you, protect me.
You tried to kill Aunt May. You tried to kill Mary Jane.
But not you. I tried to stop it.
I couldn't stop it. I would never hurt you.
I knew from the beginning.
If anything ever happened to me,
it was you that I could count on. You, Peter Parker, would save me, and so you have. Thank God for you. Give me your hand. Believe in me, as I believed in you. I've been like a father to you.
Excuse me? Okay, in what way has he been like a father to him? I mean, in the first movie, he's roommates with his son, and he meets him at the very beginning, and he's like, you know what, I'm somewhat of a scientist myself. But they don't have any chemistry building up. There's that one Thanksgiving scene, but how does that have anything to do with anything? I get it, yeah, he's a liar, he's manipulative, but there's no relationship built up between the two characters. What's the tension other than the fact that he noticed he was Spider-Man? That's really it. In the other films coming, such as Spider-Man 2, Otto Octavius and Peter Parker do have a relationship more built up than any of the other ones. But in terms of The Amazing Spider-Man, if you've seen some other videos, you might notice that one of the overarching themes of The Amazing Spider-Man film is fatherhood. And the Lizard, or Dr. Connors as you might want to say, and Peter have an actual established relationship. Check this scene out right here.
Peter.
I'm afraid I can't help you much, Peter. I don't know why they left or where they were going. Good reflexes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I read your book.
Oh.
Yeah. It's something, you know. So you really think it's possible, cross-species genetics?
Yes, of course, but for years your father and I were mocked for our theories, not just in the community at large, but at Oscorp as well. They called us mad scientists. And then your father bred the spiders and everything changed. The results were beyond encouraging. They were spectacular. We were gonna change the lives of millions, including my own. Then it was over. He was gone. Took his research with him. And I knew without him, I was angry. So I stayed away from you and your family. And for that, I'm truly sorry.
In the Raimi trilogy, I cannot name a single scene where Peter Parker and Norman Osborn have any connection. There's the scene of him at the very beginning, then there's the scene at their graduation where he says, hey, congratulations on winning the science award, but that's like all the chemistry they have. And I'm not saying that's necessarily a bad thing, but when you say that the original villain is so much better, I just don't really see where that comes into play. There's actually a relationship built up here. Yes, the plot of him trying to turn all of New York City into giant lizards is honestly kind of stupid, but I mean, also it's a story about a guy who gets bit by a spider and can crawl up walls. And you know what? The Amazing Spider-Man is not perfect in villains. Electro's character motivation, in my opinion, is kind of stupid, and I don't really count the Rhino as a villain because he's barely even a villain in the comic book series, but in terms of the relationships and chemistry, I think that The Amazing Spider-Man does it better than any other Spider-Man in film. Let's see here. You have the original Spider-Man trilogy where Mary Jane just cheats on all of her boyfriends. No, I'm not kidding. She really does that. Just go back and watch it. And then you have Spider-Man Homecoming and Far From Home. The relationship between Liz and Peter in Homecoming is just, I don't even know. And then in Far From Home, it's not bad. The actual movie's kind of centered around him trying to get with MJ, and it's not too bad. But I think that in terms of the Amazing Spider-Man franchise, him and Gwen Stacy have the most well-fleshed-out relationship by far. Check this scene out right here.
Character. It's my uncle. He's a pathological liar, and he thought you were someone else.
Oh, man, you don't have me on your computer.
I took a photo of the debate team, and you're in the debate team, so.
Right.
So he must have seen I was touching up stuff.
You're touching up stuff?
Come on. I was. I'm not gonna answer that.
Did you get expelled?
No, I didn't get expelled. I got community service. You want to, I don't know.
Want to what?
I don't know. Just, I don't know. Or we could do something else, or we could, if you don't, I mean, we could.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, either one.
Really?
Sure.
Okay, all right, good. Sounds good. Okay. Still my heart. No, I can't right now. I can't right now.
Yeah,
I'm so busy right now.
Me too. Oh.
But maybe,
yeah, just, you know.
Some other
time. All right.
Okay.
Bye.
All right. Let me in. Unlock the door. I never
felt this way before. Does something seem really familiar about that scene? Yeah, that scene was nearly copied word for word in a later Spider-Man movie within a different franchise, but that movie doesn't get criticized nearly as much. Check it out.
Hey.
Hey.
I thought you had calculus with period.
Yeah, I was just doing some homecoming stuff.
Hey, look, I just wanted to apologize about the whole decathlon thing.
It's fine.
Really.
Last week, decathlon was the most important thing, but then I almost died.
No, I just mean that it was not cool, especially because I like you.
I know.
You do?
You're terrible at keeping secrets.
Yeah, you'd be surprised. I gotta get to class, but I'd say we should hang out, but I'm gonna be in detention for ever. But I guess you already have a date to homecoming.
Actually, I'm so busy planning and I never really got around to that part, so.
You wanna go with me?
Yeah.
Really? I mean, great, cool.
Cool.
I'm actually going that way.
So, why is it okay for Spider-Man Homecoming to copy The Amazing Spider-Man, but it's not okay for The Amazing Spider-Man to copy from Spider-Man? So, while I'm on the subject of characters, not only do I think the relationships are more fleshed out in this series, but I also do not like the way Aunt May is handled in Spider-Man Homecoming. She is literally used as a plot device. It's literally just a bunch of jokes about how attractive she is. In The Amazing Spider-Man 2 and 1, there is so much with Aunt May that's not explored in other movies. She's not just some old lady in the first three Spider-Man films where she just gives off wisdom. She actually has a character arc in a way to her. So I'm going to show you a few clips so you can decide for yourself.
What are you doing?
When did you do this?
Something you're not telling me, Aunt May. Every time I mention my parents, your eyes go down. I know that you're not telling me something. You lie to me. I know you love me.
I don't
lie. I know you love me, but you do, Aunt May. Aunt May. You have to tell me, May. That's my father.
Yes, he was your father. But that didn't seem to stop him from leaving you here.
I need the truth.
The truth is, your parents left you here on our doorstep, and you were this little boy whose whole world was turned upside down with no explanation. We did the best we could. Your Uncle Ben and I. And who else was going to care for you and protect you and worry about you? Your father? No. I was the one who wiped your nose and made you brush your teeth and do your homework, who washed your dirty underwear. Me, your stupid, non-scientific aunt.
who doesn't know how to make ends meet, who has to take nursing classes with 22-year-old kids so I can pay for you to go to college. And I don't know how to do this without Ben. I don't know how. And you're dreaming about your perfect father who was never here. No. No, I won't tell you. You're my boy. As far as I'm concerned, you're my boy. And I won't hurt you.
I'm your boy. You're my everything. You're enough. You're more than enough. That's not what it's about. Don't get that twisted. I love you so much. It's okay. It's okay.
Look at me, Peter. Take off the damn hood and look at me. Where do you go? Who does this to you?
Please go to sleep, Aunt May.
Please tell me.
Aunt May, please, please, please go to sleep.
I can't sleep. Don't you understand? I can't sleep. Peter, listen to me. Secrets have a cost. They're not. Not now, not ever.
You never see anything like that of Aunt May in the other Spider-Man franchises. And in terms of other characters, I just think that the Amazing Spider-Man franchise has the best supporting cast out of any of the other ones. I love Michael Keaton's Vulture, and Jake Gyllenhaal is one of my favorite actors, and I love him as Mysterio. But the thing is another thing I always hear is complaints about Andrew Garfield as Spider-Man and Peter Parker. Okay, to start off, the biggest thing I hear is Tobey Maguire was a great Peter Parker, but Andrew Garfield is a great Spider-Man. Or I hear that Tom Holland has the best of both worlds. I personally think that Andrew Garfield, Spider-Man, and Peter Parker are both fantastic, and I'm gonna get into it right here. They always say Peter Parker in the Amazing Spider-Man franchise is way too cool. He doesn't act like Peter Parker. Then why is his intelligence constantly on display? I can't really think of many times that you notice that Tobey Maguire's Peter Parker is significantly smarter than everybody else. He does struggle balancing school and stuff, and that is one of the great things about Peter Parker is that he's an everyday man. But when we look at Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man, you're constantly seeing how smart he is. Whether it be him solving the decay rate algorithm, somewhat subject to how he looked through his father's notes, but how he creates the Spider-Man suit, how he is constantly researching, or just little scenes like this.
No, I'm trying to help you. Let me help you.
Confines of Precinct 13, receiving a 1030 on West 19th Street and Broadway. Assailant is Caucasian male, mid-30s, 170 to 180 pounds, shoulder-length blonde hair. Last seen on foot, heading eastbound on 19th Street.
Spandex.
spandex. Everything spandex.
Extraordinary velocity vector is a function of both mass and acceleration.
Oh, come on. You know better than anyone that the weight of the bob on any pendulum has no effect on swing speed.
It doesn't affect frequency, but it's totally a factor in momentum.
Yes, Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man is really dorky, but a really big thing in writing is show, not tell. And it's constantly on display of how smart Andrew Garfield's Spider-Man is. Another thing is that I do not really enjoy how they portray Peter's intelligence in the MCU. Yes, it shows that he made his web shooters and everything, but he just briefly says that he made them. That's really it. Who unhacked his suit? Ned did. Who does all of his technology things? Ned does. Where does he get his suit from? Tony Stark. And you know what? It's fine to have him not do everything, but the God-honest truth is his intelligence is never on display. Barely ever. I mean, yeah, you get to see him make webs in class in the first MCU Spider-Man, but that's about it. And he says things like, oh, your shield doesn't abide by the laws of physics at all, but I mean, that doesn't necessarily make him smart. You learn about the laws of physics in school no matter who you are. To say that Tobey Maguire and Tom Holland don't have range is completely insane. But the thing is I think Andrew Garfield's range is just so much more special. Yeah, there's the scene of Tom Holland on the plane with Happy. It's an amazing scene. Or the rumble scene where he gets attacked by the Vulture. Or there's the scenes in the original Spider-Man trilogy, like the train sequence, or when he watches his best friend die in his arms. There's so much in those movies, but I just feel like Andrew Garfield as Spider-Man gets so overlooked. Let's check out a couple scenes really quick.
Stay with me, stay with me. You stay with me. Gwen. Gwen. No, please, please.
What's at stake here? Not choice, responsibility.
That's nice. That's great. It's all well and good. So where is he?
What?
Where is he? Where's my dad? He didn't think it was his responsibility to be here to tell me this himself.
Oh, come on. How dare you?
How dare I? How dare you?
Flash showed up. Everyone was there but you.
Can't do this.
I'm sorry.
I can't.
What do you say?
I can't see you anymore. I can't.
Bug boy.
What'd you call me?
No. I know what this is.
What is it?
Every day for as long as I can remember, my father has left every morning and he's put a badge on his chest and strapped a gun to his hip. Remember, I haven't known if he was gonna make it home.
I gotta stop him, though. I have to, because I created him.
What do you mean?
I gave him an equation. It made all of this possible. Some of my father had been working on, you know. Secretly, now I realize why he kept it a secret.
Oxford, right now.
Oxford, I didn't know.
Yeah.
Okay, well.
I'm sorry to bother you, my fair lady, but my dad, madame, but who am I? I mean, who am I? I'm John Hopkins. I'm one of the young professors at Harvard, and I've been trying to get her to be a part of my team for a while now, and she's just the best person I know, and a scientific genius. And anyway, God save the Queen. And I'm sorry that everything's
happening
right. Peter,
can you just wait for 1 second? Peter, what do you want to say to me? What's the one thing? I have to go to England, Peter. It's important to me. I mean, I don't know. Maybe we're on different paths right now.
Hey. Sorry. I'm late. I got...
I'm so worried.
I know. I'm sorry.
That's a fly, Peter.
I'm so sorry. I kept you guys up. I'm insensitive. I'm irresponsible. I'm hungry.
American crime fighter.
How about that Spider-Man? Last night on the Manhattan Bridge, he saved a dozen lives. We want to hear your calls.
I think without Spider-Man, there'd be no hope for this thing. But who do you think pays the bills for all the damages he causes, huh? It's you and me, taxpayers.
Did you make this?
Yes.
This is a wind turbine. You make this?
No way.
This is amazing. It's good as new, right? I'll walk you home.
What's your name?
Jorge.
I'm Spider-Man.
You all right?
Just Spider-Man.
Costume gives it away, huh? Look, this is pretty important, Max.
How do you know my name?
It's written on your badge.
I'm a nobody.
Hey, you're not a nobody. You're somebody. Look at that. All right, listen to me. Now I need you.
Really?
You're my eyes and ears out here,
okay.
All right?
All right.
And there's a lot more scenes than the ones I just showed. That's just some examples. I just love how Andrew Garfield embraces the character of both Spider-Man and Peter Parker. And I really don't think he's been given a fair shot in terms of how good his character is. In terms of the Amazing Spider-Man franchise, is it perfect? Absolutely not. Especially in the second movie when its pacing gets pretty sloppy. But does it deserve the hate that it's received? I personally wouldn't say so. Let's look at the original Spider-Man franchise. Is it perfect either? No, but I believe it's held on a pedestal far too high. I don't think the Amazing Spider-Man franchise would get the disrespect it had if it was not a Sony reboot. See, the Amazing Spider-Man franchise has a lot of really good things going for it. It's got a great protagonist in Peter Parker, who goes through a lot of different character arcs, even in the first movie alone. It doesn't do things too quickly, and you understand everybody's motivation. I didn't really get that with the original Spider-Man franchise. And another thing is he faces a lot of consequences, unlike the new Spider-Man. The characters are also written so well in this franchise. Yeah, you have Doc Ock in the original trilogy, you have J. Jonah Jameson, who's awesome, you have Harry Osborn, but in terms of this series, one thing I loved about it so much is that Aunt May isn't a plot device, she's an actual character. Or in terms of Gwen Stacy and Peter Parker, they have a genuinely great chemistry. Also, that could have to do with the fact that Andrew Garfield and Emma Stone were dating in real life, but regardless, it just works. And in terms of the MCU Spider-Man, yeah, they have great characters too, but never do I find a dull moment with these characters. Every character in this series has something to them. I honestly couldn't tell you a thing about Liz Allen and the Spider-Man Homecoming movie. I could tell you a lot about the Vulture, but really, what is there to her? She's the captain of the decathlon team. That's really it. You know so much more about Gwen Stacy in this movie. For instance, the dialogue about how she had to watch her father put on a badge every day and wonder if he was gonna die, and then he ends up dying at the movie. These movies aren't always happy. They have a lot of consequences behind them. And you know what? A lot of Spider-Man comics are written the same way. So I've never really understood why these movies get so much compared to the other ones in terms of criticism. And you know what? A lot of the criticism is valid, but there's also criticism to be made with the other ones. I personally think that the Amazing Spider-Man franchise should be appreciated, but we'll have to look to the future on that one, because as of right now, it's not really respected, but I could see a change. I mean, Andrew Garfield was just nominated for an Oscar not too long ago with Hacksaw Ridge, but you know what? His performance as Spider-Man is also amazing. And I would say that I'd recommend The Amazing Spider-Man to anybody who wants to see a good comic book movie. I think Marc Webb is an amazing character director, and just overall director. But at the end of the day, Andrew Garfield is an amazing Spider-Man.